So I'm Dadoune on Twitter. This is my handle if you want to follow me. After the talk, I will post the slide of this talk. I have also this QR code, and this QR code is a link where you will find the resources if you need. I will also show you the QR code at the end of the talk. So if the talk was interesting, then you will be able to take pictures if you want. So I'm going to speak about how you can manage your Black Friday logs. So when you, if you don't know the Elastic platform, the Elastic platform is what we build at Elastic, and I'm one of the employees of Elastic. You can do several things with the platform. But first, before speaking about what you can do with the platform, I'm going to describe what the platform is actually. So it starts with collecting data, and to collect data, the first thing you need to do is to ingest the data to the platform, and for that we have a layer named bits. So bits are lightweight components. They are written in Go language, so a very low footprint in terms of memory, CPU, and all that things. And with the bits family, you can collect multiple things, like logs, for example. If you have file bit is going to stream your logs, and anytime you have a new line of log, it will be sent to the next step that we are going to discover just after. You have other bits component like metric bit. Metric bit is going to collect metric of the machine where metric bit is running, but also some application metrics, like if you have an Apache server, for example, you can collect also metrics from the Apache server itself or from MySQL or what have you. We have also packet bit. So packet bit is like Wireshark, if you know Wireshark. So you can get the data which is sent over the wire on the network layer, and it will descrumble the data, and it will index everything in the next step in Elasticsearch. You have multiple other bits, like Heartbeat. Heartbeat is like a ping that you are doing every 10 seconds, 5 seconds to your services, and to monitor the health, like a health check of your different services. So once you have collected data, then you can send the data to Elasticsearch. So Elasticsearch is the heart of the stack. You have multiple ways to organize your platform. I'm not going to cover that in details here. But so Elasticsearch is basically a search engine. It's more than that now. And you send JSON document inside Elasticsearch, and you can scale out, you can hold the petabytes of data if you wish. It's super, super fast. If you attended my session yesterday, you probably noticed that you can search in milliseconds in whatever volume you have, and you can scale out. So it can hold very, very a lot of data. The problem with Elasticsearch, it's only JSON. So you send JSON documents and you read JSON back, so it's only text. So you probably want to have a UI on top of that, and the UI that we have is Kibana. So Kibana is the front end. You can use Kibana if you wish, and with Kibana you will have some dashboards, some applications which reads data from Elasticsearch, and then you can display on some dashboards in your operation center if you wish. And things along those lines. If you are using FileBit for logs and sending that to Elasticsearch, most likely the logs that you are collecting are only lines of text. So you have a simple line, but inside this text, you have some structured data, actually. If you index the line as is, Elasticsearch won't be able to say, this is a timestamp, this is the HTTP code, or what have you. So what it means that you need to parse the data. To parse the data, you can use something that we call Logstash. So Logstash is an ETL, where you extract data from a source, either from bits, you transform data on the fly, and then you load the data that you transform inside Elasticsearch. So for that, you can parse your log, for example, and say, OK, so this part of the log is a timestamp, this other part of the log is the byte size of the response, or what have you, things along those lines. You can also extract geo coordinates. If you have an IP address, you can use in Logstash a GeoIP filter, and it will transform the IP address to latitude and longitude points. Then you will be able to display all that in Kibana, for example. So this is the purpose of Logstash. Logstash can also read data from other sources. Like if you have a data source, for example, you can read data from this data source, and same thing, send that to Elasticsearch. You can also imagine that you are reading a log, a line of log from with Filebit. You read that in Logstash, and within this line of log, maybe you have an ID of a user. Then in Logstash, you can do a lookup in the database, get all the information about the user, so enhance the event, and then send to Elasticsearch the full event containing the user information, for example. So Logstash is super flexible for that. And I said it's ETL, so it means that you can send data to Elasticsearch, but you can send also data to other destinations. Like you want to send your data also to Kafka, to Redis, to S3, what have you. So super flexible things. I like the fact that you can, for example, archive on S3. Instead of sending everything and keeping everything inside Elasticsearch, you can just collect the data with Filebit here, send the data to Elasticsearch to be indexed, but also to S3 to be archived. And then every 7 days, you can remove some data from Elasticsearch. So this is what you can do with the platform. Sometimes we have also users who are using a message queue system in the middle, like you can send from Bits to Kafka or Redis, read again from Logstash, so very flexible architecture. So this is basically the what we call the Elastic Stack, with Bits, Logstash, Elasticsearch, and Kibana. On top of that, we are offering some services, some solutions, like we released 2 years ago, the application performance monitoring, which is a different kind of thing. It's like Bits, but with also a specific UI. So a lot of features we just released the SIEM application, so all about security. So this is what you can do. You can download everything, so all this part is open source. You can download everything and just manage it by yourself. We have a version for enterprise when you can deploy clusters super easily. And we have this same software, which is running on AWS, Google Cloud Platform, and Azure, and which is our Elastic Cloud, so you can have everything as a service that we manage. So the purpose of this talk, and this is a question that I often have, is how you can size actually Elasticsearch, because Elasticsearch is the heart of the stack, and this is the most important thing you need to care about. So you need to understand first some terminologies. So I'm going to explain some of the terms that I'm going to use. When you index data inside Elasticsearch, you are actually indexing in what we call an index. And so an index can contain different kind of documents here. So here I have an index for Twitter, and I have those documents. And Elasticsearch is a multi-tenant system, which means that in the same cluster, you can have multiple indices for different use cases. For example, I have the logs index, which contains totally different data than the Twitter index. All the index are stored, and all the data is physically stored on a node. So a node is a GVM instance. And this is running physically on a server. And if you have multiple nodes, those nodes all together are making a cluster. When you send a document to an index, actually, the index is split in what we call shards. So in the past version of Elasticsearch, before version 7, we used to have, by default, 5 shards per index, which means that... So what is a shard? A shard is a subset of the index. And a shard is, behind the scene, a Lucene instance. Lucene is the library that we are using in Elasticsearch. So each shard here is a Lucene instance. And what is Lucene? Lucene is basically a search engine. So here, for example, for this index Twitter, we have 5 search engines, one year, and one year. Okay? So when we send a document to be indexed inside the index Twitter, this document can be all by the shard 0, shard 1, shard 2, shard 4, etc. Each index can have its own settings, so you can decide that the index logs, for example, will have only two shards. Okay? So you have this terminology, cluster, server, nodes, index, then shards. The shard is super important. You will see that in a second. If you want to scale out, what you can do is to say, okay, I'm going to start a new node on a new machine, on a new physical machine. Those two nodes are going to communicate together, and they are going to belong to the same cluster. And then what Elasticsearch is going to do, Elasticsearch is going to relocate the shards and say, I'm not going to keep all the shards on the same physical machine because it's a waste of resources, so I'm going to move the shards elsewhere. And this is what is going to happen automatically behind the scene. So some Twitter shards moved to this new server, and same for the logs here. It moved here. When the problem with that, and this is the same thing with the previous picture, is that imagine that you are losing the node B. The node B is suddenly failing. What is going to happen? You won't be able to search the whole data anymore. You will have only a subset of the data. You will still be able to search, but you won't be able to search for the whole documents. So one of the overall notions that Elasticsearch introduced is the notion of replication. So you can have, and by default, you have one replica per primary shard that exists in the cluster. And what is a replica? It's basically the same, it's a perfect copy, I would say, of the primary shard. So here, I have three documents in this shard primary four. On the other node, I have a replica which contains exactly the same documents, which means that if I'm losing this node, I don't care because I have the whole data elsewhere and the other way around. Make sense so far? Cool. If you add a node C, then the same thing that we have seen before will happen. Elasticsearch is going to automatically redistribute all the shards for you. There won't be any stop of the service, so everything will still very fine. So we have cluster, server, node, index, shard, primaries, and replicas. When you start a project with Elastic, you start with one node, you start to index some documents, and at some point you say, okay, I want to have replication, so I'm going to add a new node to have this replication that I mentioned. And then maybe I have more and more data, so if I have more and more data, I need probably to have more and more machines, so I'm going to scale out and add more and more power to my cluster. And at some point you will have a big data project, maybe. I don't like this term, but okay, it's often used. And remember that in Elasticsearch, the shard is the working unit. A shard is a working unit. And the more data you have, the more shards you will need to hold all the data. And the main question is, how many shards do you need? What is the answer? How many? How? So the answer is, it depends. It depends. Okay, that's always the answer that we are going to give you on the forum or wherever. It really depends, right? We don't know. So it depends. We are going to see that. We are going to cover. I hope that I'm going to answer this question. Okay. So let's take an example. Let's say that we are injecting 1,000 events per second. It means that we per day we inject 87 events per day. Let's say that we have 1 kilobyte per event. It means that we have approximately 82 gigabytes of data that we are collecting per day. And we want to have 3 months of retention period, which means that we need to hold, in total, 7 terabytes of data. I'm not speaking about the replicas here, just the primary volume. Okay, so 7 terabytes of data. the most important term, again, is the shard, the most important thing in Elasticsearch. So you need to understand what is the typical shard size that you can have for your use case. And it really depends on your use case. If you are doing logs and you have one query every, I don't know, hour because you are trying to find one line of log, it's totally different than if you have if you are Uber, for example, like or Lyft or what have you, and then you and you try to find a driver nearby you because you have a lot of requests coming together at the same time. So it depends on the use case, it depends on the size of the data. So it's really hard to compute and to give you a number. But we have a very nice resource here available online on our website. It's old but still accurate, and this talk can give you the way to actually find what is the typical size of a shard before you are hitting a limit. How you do that, in short, you actually test it. You try to load as much as you can the data in one single shard, and then you try to hit the limit. So you search at the same time, and then when the search is not fast enough, you said, okay, so the typical size of a shard is, for example, 45 gigabytes. After this limit, I cannot inject more data. It will be a pain for my user, so I don't want to do that. And then with the same method, then you try to understand also how many shards you can hold per machine. So what is the limit of your machine? Of course, you do that on real production machine. You don't do that theoretically. So let's say that after the recommendation here, I found that my shard can contain 45 gigabytes of data, and I can have up to 10 shards per machine. So how many shards? Super easy now. You know that you have 7 terabytes of data. A shard size can be 45 gigabytes of data. It means that you need to hold 160 shards. Okay, simple as that. You can have only 10 shards per machine. It means that you need 16 nodes. Okay, simple. For 3 months of logs. Okay. The question is now, okay, I mentioned the number of shards, but how many indices? You can have only one single index with 160 shards. Okay, that's fine. But what happens if you have this Black Friday event and you don't really know what will be the traffic on your website? Maybe you are going to collect much more data than 82 gigabytes per day. Maybe it will be 240 gigabytes per day for those days. So if you said that you define in the stone that it's only 160 shards for one single index, maybe that's not the good thing to do. And what about removing data? I said that I want to keep only 3 months of data online. It means that I need to delete some data. If you want to delete something in Elasticsearch, you can send a delete request to delete one document. But what is going to happen behind the scene? Actually, Elasticsearch is going to add in a file, an information that a document has been removed. It means that the more you delete, the more space you consume. Right? After that, you will have like a garbage collector mechanism where we are going to remove effectively the data, but it's not super efficient to actually remove documents in one index. Instead of doing that, you can use the fact that we have a time-based data. And when you have time-based data, you can come with different solutions. So what are time-based data? Basically, you have a timestamp and some data associated with it. Typically, the use case is that you are searching only for the recent event. So like 90% of the case, you are looking at the events from the last day, for example. And you don't update documents. We don't support time travel, so you don't update the previous logs. It does not exist. And also with time-based data, as I said, for the Black Friday event, you cannot really predict what will be the data size for the future. So you need to adapt constantly. And when you have time-based data, you have a solution in Elasticsearch, is to use time-based indices. This is the best option. So instead of having one big index with 160 shards, you are going to create one index per period, like per day, for example, per week, per month, per year, maybe less than that. We have some users who have extreme use cases, like they are indexing 10 million documents per second, so probably they have hourly indices, I guess. And by default, with Logstash and Bits, we use daily indices. So when you collect with Bits information, you will generate one index per day. The cool thing with Elasticsearch is that you can search within multiple indices at the same time. So searching in one index with 160 shards or searching in 10 indexes with 16 shards each is exactly the same thing, exactly the same cost for Elasticsearch. At the end, you search in 160 shards. Okay? So it does not change anything. But it comes with some bonus that I'm going to explain. So what is daily indices? Basically, you start to collect your logs with Filebit, and you are sending your logs for this day in this index. And then, the day after, you are just going to create a new index with a new timestamp, and then you are going to send the new data to this new index. And same goes to the next day, right? So, when you create an index, you probably want to configure the index. And I'm pretty sure that you don't want to be awake at midnight just to create the index before the data is coming. So in Elasticsearch, we created what we call the templates. And the templates are automatically applied when a new index must be created. So for example, let's say that for every single index which starts with logs dash as a name, we want to have two shards and one replica for each primary shard. And we want to have 60 seconds refresh interval. I'm going to cover this thing later. You can define a template like this. So this is a simple API call that you send to Elasticsearch. I have my logs template. And anytime you have logs dash something index name, then create a new index with those settings. So you can put here the mapping, all the things that you need in Elasticsearch. What is cool with that is that imagine that you know that you will have this Black Friday event. You can say before the Black Friday, okay, I know that I'm probably going to have more traffic than the usual traffic, so I can update the template the day before. I say, okay, instead of two shards, I'm going to put 10 shards, for example. And then automatically, the next day, the index will be created with 10 shards. And then after the event, you can update again the template and say, now I want again only two shards, and you are back to normal. Right? OK. I want to speak about aliases. Alias is a super important feature. And if you use Elasticsearch, please use aliases. If you don't know exactly why today, use aliases, and then at some point you will thank me, saying that, okay, that was a good advice. So use that. So what is an alias? An alias is like a symbolic link to an index. I can have here an alias named logswrite, which goes to this index. And I can have also an alias logsread, which also goes to this index. When I want to write data, so when I'm collecting data, instead of writing to logs dash a date, then I'm just going to write to logs dash write. That's all. Okay. When I'm reading from my application as a user, when I'm reading the data, instead of having to know what is the form of the index name here, I'm just going to use logs read as the index name, but actually the alias. Okay, so I'm reading in logsread. What will happen the next day? I'm just going to create the new index, and I'm just going to switch the alias for write. So now, instead of writing in the first index, I'm going to write in the second one. But for the read, I'm going to add to the logsread alias also this index, which means that now, if I'm searching in logsread, I'm searching in both indices at the same time. But I don't have to care as the end user. I'm just searching in one virtual index, which is logsread. Okay? and same will happen for the next day. So IACs are super powerful for that feature. I want to introduce the rollover API. Someone asked me yesterday about that, so that's cool to have this session today, actually. So what is the rollover API? The rollover API will help you to rollover aliases, which means that when you hit a limit, like a number of documents per index or a size per index, for example, let's say that you have one shard, how much? I said 45 gigabytes of data per shard. This is what I said, yeah. So let's say that I have one index with one shard and I define in the rollover API when I call it that the size limit for my index is 45 gigabytes, then automatically Elasticsearch is going to create a new index for you, rollover the alias, which means switch the alias for you, and then you will be able to write automatically to the new index without knowing everything. So it's just something that you call periodically, like every 5 minutes if you wish, and Elasticsearch will check if you raise that limit, and if you raise that limit, it will do the switch that we have seen before, but automatically. So super convenient API to use. So don't keep the default values. I said that we changed that in 7.0, I think, the default values, but if you are still using an older version, like a 6.x, you can have some troubles. Why this? Let's say that I am collecting in my Elasticsearch cluster some access logs, some application logs, some MySQL logs, for example. So three different kind of logs. I have one index per day, 1 gigabyte per index. This is what I'm collecting. I have 5 shards by default, which means 200 megabytes per shard. Remember that we can hold 45 gigabytes per shard, so we can imagine yet that's a waste of resources. I want 6 months retention, which means that I will have 900 shards for 100 gigabytes. Well, we needed 4 shards, actually, to hold all that. But here, because we are keeping all the defaults, yeah, we are going to have some troubles, actually. Why this? Because each shard comes with a lot of overhead. Each shard is a Lucene instance, as I said. So the more shards you have, the more memory you are going to use on the Elasticsearch cluster, etc. So you should really be careful about the default values. Maybe here, in that case, I don't want to have one index per day, but maybe one index per week or one index per month is totally enough. And probably I don't want to have 5 shards. That's the thing. Let's have a look at something else. So let's say that we have an e-commerce website and we have this Black Friday event which is happening. We know, because we test that with our current architecture, we can hold up to 1 million users on our search engine. But with the Black Friday event, we have now 2 million users. So how can we manage that? So what you can do is to start new instances, and you can change the number of replicas. Instead of having one replica per primary shard, you can say, now I can have 2 replicas per primary shard. And because, as I mentioned before, each replica is a perfect copy of the primary, it means that now you can serve more search than before. Instead of searching the search from one primary and one replica, so only 2 shards, now you can search from 3 shards, one primary, one replica, and one other replica. And same happen if you have, again, 1 million users more. You start new machines, you increase the number of replicas, and then you will be able to serve much more requests than before. So on this axis, depending on the number of requests you have, you can deal with the number of replicas to manage that. After the event, you can reduce the number of replicas again, and then remove the machine because you don't need them, and go back to normal with only 16 machines. So shards are really the working unit. the more data you have, the more shards you need. And if you want to improve the write throughput, because you are going to write in multiple shards at the same time in parallel, then the more writes you have, the more primary shards you will need. And replicas are used for high availability. When you are losing a primary, then you have a replica, but also for the read throughput, as I mentioned, the more reads you have, the more replicas you want to have. We introduce two nice APIs. One API is the Shrink API. It helps you to say, okay, for example, I have created one index for my Black Friday event with 10 shards because I had a lot of data to collect at this moment. But now the search that I'm running on this log index are really non-significant, so a very low number of search requests. So maybe instead of having 10 shards, I can reduce that to 2 shards or only 1 shard. If you call the Shrink API, you will be able to do that. So basically, you will merge all the shards all together in one single shard, for example, and you will reduce the memory consumption that I mentioned before that you have per shard. And we have exactly the same and the opposite API, which is the Split API, where you can do exactly the opposite thing, like you have one index with 2 shards and you can multiply by 2 and say, okay, now I will have one index with 4 shards if you need that. So it makes the thing more flexible than it used to be. I want to introduce the notion of bulk. So when you index a document, you can do that by one HTTP request for each document. But the problem with that is that you are going to open an HTTP communication, and then you are going to send the payload with all the headers and all the things, and then you are going to get back the response. And this is not the most efficient thing that you can do. So instead, you can use bulk, and instead, for example, if you have 1,000 logs events, instead of sending 1,000 HTTP requests one by one, you can use the bulk API to send one bulk request with 1,000 documents. So it's only one HTTP call, which contains all the things you want to index, and then you will get only one response back. Okay, so it's much more efficient. It saves you network bandwidth, file descriptors to hold each request on Elasticsearch site, so this is very interesting. But the question is, what is the optimal bulk size you want to have? For 1,000 events, do you want to have 4 bulk requests with 250 requests, or two requests, or only one request? You know the answer? It depends. That's the answer. So it depends on many things. Your application, the document size, this is super important. If you have documents which are 1 megabyte or more, then probably you don't want to send 1,000 documents each time, and probably it won't work. It depends on the number of nodes, the node size, number of shards, shard distribution, and all that things. And the only way to know how many and what is the best size for your use case is to test it. So you test, you measure, you take 1,000 log events, for example, you send that to Elasticsearch, with 4,000 requests of 250, and you measure the time that it takes, and then you know what is the sweet spot for your use case. So one colleague of mine wrote this Logstash pipeline here. So this is typically a Logstash pipeline. I'm reading from standard in, I'm not doing any transformation, so the filter is empty. And as the output, I'm sending to Elasticsearch to one host. Here, and the flush size here is typically the bulk size. So how many events I want to collect before sending and sending yet the HTTP request to Elasticsearch. In bits, there is this bulk underscore max size option, which is the same thing that you can set. And then he wrote this script. Basically, he's reading the 1 million logs file, and he's trying multiple size here. And he's just trying that 20 times, and then he's trying to measure what is the response time. So when he did this test, it was a long time ago, but still, so we had two nodes on AWS with those characteristics. It tested that. Of course, the nodes that you are using for Elasticsearch, you don't put Logstash and Kibana on that. You just keep Elasticsearch alone. And then you do your test, and you can see that probably the sweet spot is around 5,000 documents. Okay. Next, distribute the load. When you send a request to Elasticsearch, you don't send a request to a cloud, a virtual thing, you send a request to a machine, so to a HTTP port. Probably, you don't want to send the request always to the same node. If you do that to the single node, then it means that this node is going to be overloaded by all the requests. Even though the index operation will not happen here, but on an other node, which all the data, but this one is going to get all the requests. And maybe you don't want to do that. And instead, you can specify a seed list. So in Logstash, for example, you can do that. You can specify the node address that you want to hit. And automatically, Logstash here is going to do a round robin to either send the data to node 1 or to node 2. So it will be super helpful. Bits also allows that to send that to multiple names. And in case of failure, of course, you won't have any break because those products will be able to send that to the right data. You can also use a load balancer in front of Elasticsearch. I don't really like this method. Why this? Because the load balancer is not smart. The load balancer is going to send the data to node 1 or node 2, but maybe the data that you want to send the index you want to send the data to is only all on the node 1. But because the load balancer is not smart, maybe it's going to send the request to the node 2, and the node 2 is going to process the data to send the data to the node 1 because the node 1 holds the data. So it's not smart enough. Instead, you can use what we call a coordinating node in Elasticsearch. So the coordinating node is basically a node which belongs to the cluster, but without any data. So it's only a setting. You said node.data false, and this node won't have any data. But then when you send the request to the coordinating node, because this node belongs to the cluster, this node knows exactly where the shards are. So instead of sending to whatever node, it will send the request to the right to the right node, which holds the shard. You need to test that again. So same as before, you test in Logstash, for example, and then you measure if there is an effect with round robin or without round robin. Here, it's not super significant, but it's still better, right, with round robin. Last, I think it's last, but not least, I/O. Of course, don't use a spinning disk if you want to have high performance. In production, use SSD drives. That's a good advice. At least when you index heavily. When you search, it's a different story. If you are only doing search use case, then spinning disk is okay. But if you are looking for performance at index time, then use SSD drives. So I want to explain what is happening behind the scene when you index a document in Elasticsearch. So when you send an index request to Elasticsearch, the document is actually held in a buffer at some point. And then you send another index request, and then another index request, and all those requests are accumulated all together in a buffer. And at some point, Elasticsearch is going to trigger what we call a Lucene flush. And when this is called, we generate what we call a segment. So a segment is the data structure that we need to be able to search the data. Which means that when you send a document, you cannot search immediately. There is a delay between the response that you get from Elasticsearch and the fact that the segment is available for search. By default, we refresh every second, which means that you can end with a lot of micro segments in memory on Elasticsearch Child, and which means that you are going to consume maybe a lot of memory. If you don't care about the fact that you need to see the documents super quickly, instead of having this use case where you need to find the document after 1 second, if you are okay, for example, to say, okay, I can wait for 1 minute before this document is available for search, then you can send what I mentioned before, the refresh interval. The refresh interval is exactly that. Instead of saying, I want to refresh every second, which is the default, you can update the settings. This is a dynamic value. You can say, now I want to have this refresh interval of 60 seconds, which means that I'm going to create a segment every 60 seconds, and instead of 60 segments in 1 minute. So if you increase that, you will get better throughput. But the drawback is that it will take more time for your documents to be available for search. Again, you test, you measure, and you see that, okay, there is an effect, so maybe this is something you can use to enhance that. When you index a document, I said that this document goes to a buffer, and at some point we have this flush, which is generating a listening segment. But we, at the same time, we are also collecting this information in what we call a transaction log. So this is changing, we are going to change that in the future. So you have those segments in memory, but at some point you are going to store the segment on disk, right? But what happens if in this time you have a crash of your node? Then the documents are gone. That's the reason we have this transaction log, okay? Which means that even though we have a crash of the machine, if the machine starts again, it will read again the transaction log and it will process again the data that has not been indexed. So it will regenerate again the segments, okay? When we do what we call an Elasticsearch flush, which is a Lucene commit behind the scene, the Lucene commit is going to generate a segment on disk and do a fsync to be sure that everything is written on disk, and then we will be able to remove the transaction log and empty the transaction log. In older version, we used to have a transaction log which was not fsynced, which means that we were doing that in an asynchronous manner. So anytime we had an operation, we were writing that to the transaction log, but we were fsyncing every 5 seconds, which means that we might lose some data if something was going wrong. Even though you have a replica, if both systems are failing at the same time, like you are super, super unlucky, then you can have some documents which are missing, which was not a good thing. So we changed that, and now we are fsyncing on every single request. That's the reason I mentioned if you are using bulk, it's much better, because what you are going to fsync is the bulk request altogether. Instead of 1,000 of fsync that you need to do, you will do only one single fsync, which is better. But fsyncing every single operation has a cost, of course. So what you can do, if you wish, you can change and go back to the old behavior. Instead of fsyncing for every single request, you can do that asynchronously and say, I want to change the sync interval to 5 seconds, for example. But be aware that you are relaxing the safety guarantees and you can have a loss of documents. So if you don't care of your documents, you can do that. Maybe you will see also here again if you do that asynchronous fsync. So, some final remarks. I mentioned what you can do with the stack. There is a very flexible architecture that I introduced before. Remember that the shard is the working unit, and we learned that the more data you have, the more shards you will need in terms of primaries, but don't overshard. That's really something you need to keep in mind. Replicas are used for high availability, and the more reads you have, the more replicas you want to have as well. Test it, you bulk, you test, you distribute the load, you refresh the interval, you can play with that, and you can touch this setting. I'm not a big fan of this one, but if you want to touch it, you can do that. And then at the end, you can probably see an improvement on your system. So if you want to have access to the presentation later, you can copy the QR code. And spasiba. So, what's next? The question, c'est ça?
Da, it's just Slido. Slido. What is the question?
So, so do you connect to Slido? Do I have to?
Помоги, пожалуйста.
Давайте мы пока из зала микрофон отдадим. Вот у нас есть человек. First question.
Okay, thank you. Those are the questions. Okay, thank you.
Hi, thanks for descriptive presentation for Elasticsearch. Mm-hmm. The company that I'm working for would be soon your customer. So
cool.
Yeah, I have a question in two
you
parts.
You mean a paid customer? Or?
Yes.
Oh, cool. Awesome.
It's the only one, I guess.
No.
So I have a question in two parts.
Yeah.
First part is, do you have write and read throughput metrics when you are writing to an index?
You want me to do that? Yeah. I think that we are collecting this data. If we are not, I think that with the because we have the monitoring tool, which is available in Elasticsearch, and I think that with that we are collecting all this information. I did not check, but yes, I'm pretty sure we have that.
Okay, then out of the box. Second part of my question: is it possible to scale out shards in regards of those metrics?
Automatically, you mean?
Like the case you explained with Black Friday, for instance, lots of data is coming to the same index. Yeah. So the throughput metric for write would be significantly high.
Yeah, yeah.
And in this case, it is probably possible to increase shards amounts.
Yeah, but we are not doing that automatically.
Yeah, yeah. That is my question.
No, no, you are. No,
is it possible?
No. Not yet. Okay. This is something we are thinking about, specifically in the context of the Elastic Cloud Enterprise that I mentioned before, because this thing is collecting and managing the cluster. So probably at some point we will have something along those lines. But for now, I'm personally not a big fan of that, because, for example, starting new nodes automatically means moving a lot of shards around the cluster.
It's a lot of network traffic, of course, but I mean only like shards on existing machines. Like, do not start up any additional nodes, just imagine, just have some resources in the stash, and then you could fire up.
So for now, I don't think you can do that magically, but you can have the you can generate alerts on Elasticsearch, because you will be a paid customer, you will have access to the alert system.
Cool.
And then with this alert system, you can fire whatever HTTP event, which is maybe to call one of the API of Elasticsearch and to create a new index, to roll over the alias or what have you. So with that, you can do that, but there is nothing automatic right now for that.
Yep. Okay. Okay, got it. Thanks.
You're welcome. Another question here, or Slido? Slido.
Slido.
What about Kibana authentication? So from 6.8 and 7.3, the authentication is available for free with the what we call the basic license, which is free. So you can just download it and activate the security, and then you will have authentication in Elasticsearch and obviously in Kibana as well. If you want to connect to third-party system like LDAP system or do Kerberos authentication or things along the line, then you need to have a commercial license for that. But otherwise, you have that out of the box from 6.8 and 7.3. What about bulk insert operation response code with error? So yeah, when you get back the response from Elasticsearch, the bulk response is a very big document. And basically, if I recall correctly, at the top you have a summary, like, do I have errors somewhere? And if you have errors, then you need to parse the array of the response, and for each document that you have sent, read the response and see if there is an error or not. That answer the question? hopefully. Why do we need to care about size and number of shards? Maybe using single shard per index, rollover plus size on alias is all what we need. Yeah, that's true. That's true. I can, yeah. You can, yeah, probably generate one index with one single shard. That's a very good point. Does Kibana support SSO with SAML? Yes, but you have to have a license for that, a commercial license for this one. This is what you just mentioned, sorry. So it used to be called XPack, but it's now packaged altogether. But yeah, so either the gold or platinum, I don't remember what is the level, but it's not available with the basic license. Okay. Any alternative to KQL? So KQL is the Kibana query language that we have, and we do have indeed a SQL endpoint now. So you can run SQL queries in Elasticsearch with the underscore SQL endpoint. And we have also GDBC connectors. So the underscore SQL endpoint is available for free in the basic license. If you want to use the GDBC connector or the ODBC connector to connect third-party system like Excel or whatever, you, Power BI or what you want, then you need to have a commercial license for this one. Yeah.
What is your last question?
Was my French English okay?
Yeah, that's great, okay, actually. Cool. The question is related to the theme of our conference, big data, the word that you don't like. But is there any solutions to connect Elasticsearch to some kind of this zoo related to Spark and Hadoop? Because, for example, we are using pandas in Log4j to and special application called Flume, if you know mm-hmm. such, to just append and write logs into HDFS directly. Mm-hmm. So Flume does all the job and is collecting the logs and put there in HDFS in proper directories. Mm-hmm. So the question is whether we are able to just add Elasticsearch to Flume and somehow to collaborate them.
So I think you have multiple options for that. One of the options you have is to use our project name ES Hadoop, which is Elasticsearch for Hadoop, where you can basically connect Elasticsearch and the Hadoop world. You can connect with Pig, Hive, or all those things. But at the end, you will need to index data inside Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is not going to read the data from HDFS directly, right? But you will need to index the data inside Elasticsearch. And with this project, it will be easy to do that. And you can do also the other way around. Let's say that you have some Hadoop jobs that you wrote, and then instead of running the job on HDFS only, maybe you can also call Elasticsearch. So you have a jar file that you can put in your jobs, and then instead of querying Hadoop, then you can benefit from the speed of Elasticsearch within your Hadoop job. So both ways is working. Okay.
Друзья, аплодисменты. Аплодисменты. Дэвид, thank you for your speech and your fast help us.